Making a slot canyon. Well, that begs the question, what is a slot canyon? A slot canyon is a canyon in bedrock that has basically vertical walls and is much deeper than it is wide. Presumably has some length, although the one I'm showing you here is probably about five times as long as it is wide. This particular talk is about a slot canyon that was being deepened in front of the eyes of some geologists, namely Joel Johnson, Kellen Whipple, and Leonard Sklar. And they published their findings in the GSA bulletin under the title Contrasting Bedrock Incision Rates from Snowmelt and Flash Floods in the Henry Mountains, Utah. And to give you an idea, I'll give you the abstract. Hydrograph variability, that just means what water makes, and channel morphology influence rates of fluvial bedrock incision. Fluvial is just a fancy word for river. But little data exists on these controls in natural channels. Through field monitoring, we demonstrate that, one, short-term bedrock channel incision can be rapid, and you'll see how rapid. Two, sustained floods with smaller peak discharges can be more erosive than flash floods with higher peak discharges, due to changes in bed alluviation. That means the stuff that's laying on the bottom. And three, bedrock channel morphology varies with local bed slope and controls the spatial distribution of erosion. It erodes where it wants to and has to do with the shape of the bedrock channel. We present a three-year record of flow depths and bedrock erosion for a human-perturbed channel reach that drains the Henry Mountains of Utah, USA. Starting from a small and steep, approximately 30% slope, that's pretty steep, engineered nick point in Navajo sandstone, erosion has cut a narrow, deep, and tortuous inner channel in about 35 to 40 years. Along the inner channel, we measured up to 1/2 meter of vertical incision into Navajo sandstone over approximately 23 days. Grinding it right into the rock, 0.5 meter in 23 days, caused by the 2005 season of exceptional snowmelt flow. In contrast, flash floods caused little bedrock incision even when peak discharges were much higher than the peak snowmelt flow. Flash floods were net depositors of coarse sediment, while snowmelt flow cleared alluvial cover. We document the formation of a pothole and interpret that it was abraded by bed load rather than by fine suspended sediment. That means pebbles, rocks, rather than sand. Finally, several slot canyons, Peekaboo, Spooky, and Coyote Gulch Narrows, in the nearby Escalante River drainage basin have erosional morphology similar to the monitored channel reach. Feedbacks between flow, sediment transport, and transient erosion provide a plausible explanation for the evolution of channel slope, width, and bed roughness of these natural bedrock channels. It's not just a matter of dumping water, you have to dump it in the right way, in other words. Introduction. Do large floods with greater stream power and boundary shear stresses cause more bedrock channel erosion than smaller flow events? Understanding how the magnitude of floods influences bedrock erosion rates and patterns is central to understanding and predicting channel and landscape erosion rates and their sensitivity to climate over short and long time scales. Magnitude frequency trade-offs in the erosion of bedrock channels, for example, Baker, and for those of you who are curious, that is V. Baker, Victor Baker of one of the students of J. Harlan Brett's, Wool, Howard, Lang et al., et cetera, are likely different from alluvial channels, which are from another set of references. In alluvial channels, morphologic adjustment occurs through the entrainment and deposition of sediment. In incising bedrock channels, morphology changes not only through sediment redistribution, but additionally requires the detachment of bedrock by a variety of erosion processes. In this paper, we restrict our analysis to bedrock channels. And I'm going to talk about alluvial fans, stuff like that. Hartshorne measured bedrock erosion in Taiwan and found more bedrock lowering from a large typhoon flood compared to subsequent smaller floods, not surprisingly. However, when normalized by the estimated recurrence interval, approximately 20 years, the large flood gave lower annual incision rates, 1.7 millimeters per year and 0.3 millimeters per year, depending on the rock. Then smaller floods with approximately yearly recurrence intervals, which 6 millimeters per year and 2 millimeters per year, respectively. Now, translate that. What that means is you multiply the 1.7 times 20, and you get 34 compared with 6, and you get 6 compared with 2. So the typhoon erodes quite a bit more, but it's just that the typhoons are less common. They interpreted that in this part of Taiwan, large floods with moderate recurrence intervals, at least today, are less important to long-term bedrock river erosion than more frequent but smaller events. Alluvial cover and sediment supply effects provide a physical mechanism by which bedrock incision may be a non-unique function of flood magnitude. In the saltation abrasion model, bedload sediment enables incision by providing tools for abrasive impact. Bedload is the stuff that's kind of rolling around on the bottom of this water, which of course means usually larger material. We'll see some bedload in just a little bit. However, at higher sediment loads, relative to the transport capacity of the flow, deposition may partly or completely cover the bed and inhibit impact wear and most other erosion mechanisms, called the cover effect. If you have enough stuff in the water, some of it will settle out and the water will try to erode what it just settled out instead of going after the bedrock bed. Laboratory experiments have shown the importance of cover effects in inhibiting short-term incision. The rates and patterns of erosion in Taiwan observed by Hartshorn et al. Were influenced by tools and cover effects with bed alluviation commonly preventing thalweg incision during large typhoon floods. The thalweg is the very bottom part of the stream. So the typhoon covered up, at least the typhoon floods covered up the very bottom with sediment and therefore didn't erode it as much as you might think. We hypothesize that in field settings with different relationships between coarse sediment supply and flood hydrology, the relative roles of semiannual and extreme flood events can be markedly different. Thus, an important question is whether the observations of Hartshorn et al. And Tarasky et al. Are generally true or specific only to those channels in Taiwan, or even to that particular sequence of flood events. Well, this is being very, very cautious about drawing conclusions. In addition to magnitude-frequency relations, feedback between channel width, alluvial cover, bed roughness, longitudinal slope, and incision rate are poorly understood. Understanding how these morphological parameters mutually evolve in response to upstream discharge and sediment flux and downstream base level changes is important for predicting the response of channels and landscapes to tectonic, climatic, or land use forcing. In this particular case, it will be land use forcing. And I'm not going to read it all, obviously, otherwise we'd be here for several hours. In the present work, we directly measure the relationship between flood hydrographs and bedrock incision rate by monitoring flood events and erosion, albeit in a single channel reach over a short period of time, namely 3 years. Rapid bedrock incision has occurred at our monitoring site in response to human modification of the local channel reach. The hydrology of floods in our ephemeral channel is very different from the mountains of Taiwan, giving an opportunity to expand the parameter space in which flow and bedrock incision has been monitored. So we're starting to generalize a little bit. Finally, we present a case study of the morphology of several natural slot canyons in the Escalante River drainage basin in Utah. We argued that the similarity in channel morphology between the monitor channel and these natural slot canyons suggests that the feedbacks we interpret between sediment transport, bedrock erosion, and channel morphology are commonplace. This happens all the time, in other words. The field area that they're talking about is Sweat Creek, which drains the southeast side of Mount Hillers. Peak elevation 3,273 meters, that's over 10,000 feet high, in the Henry Mountains in Utah. While constructing Highway 276 over Sweat Creek, approximately 1970, the Utah Department of Transportation initiated an experiment in bedrock incision by filling a canyon and rerouting the natural channel through a culvert and blasted bedrock slot. Figure one. Now let me show you their photo. And here's up here is Highway 276 going across. They've made a huge amount of fill. They blasted a channel here. You can't see the flume, but we will soon. There's a culvert that goes underneath that massive frog. A massive culvert, by the way. It drains down into here, and then this is where it meets the old channel. And you can see there's a nice incised canyon there, little canyon, but it's better than a meter high. And there's the inner channel that's cut straight into the sandstone. Now, let me show you where that is approximately. This is the Henry Mountains. There's the mountain that we were seeing that's over 10,000 feet high. It drains to here, which drains out to here, and this is the Sweat Canyon, Sweat Creek drainage area, Sweat Creek itself, and on out into here. I'm going to switch to this is Google Maps. This is now the same, well, a little bit closer. You can't see the highway from this distance, but what you can see is the drainage pattern that goes out over to here to Lake Powell. So let's get a little closer. And here you can see the highway. This is an actual satellite photo going through and showing the road. And there's the canyon. You'll notice that it's got its own little incised areas. Let's come a little closer. And now you can see the highway going across. This is oriented with north at the top. And it's obviously shot in the morning because that's where the shadows are coming from. And here is the bedrock channel that they blasted out. And right there is our little canyon. It actually shows on Google Earth. And you can see there's the opening of the culvert, and the other opening of the culvert is about here. And here's the old channel that's been covered up, and now it's running into that. This is taking a view from approximately this area here. So you're looking up, and here you can see where they blasted out. And there's our little canyon right there. And here we have a little bit of a canyon right in here too. And there's the drainage pattern, you can see. And there's our original photo, so you can kind of get it, that orients you, I think, a little bit. To go on with the article, we have monitored bedrock erosion through this human-perturbed bedrock reach, providing an opportunity to observe the morphological evolution of a bedrock channel from a well-constrained initial geometry. Directly downstream of the culvert, diameter 4.3 meters, that's about 23 feet. That's a big culvert. Length 70 meters, slope 2%, 2.4%. The vertical-walled blasted bedrock channel diversion has an upper reach, the flume, length about 80 meters. That's the part that they blasted. And that slope is 0.02% again, width about 5 meters, about 16 feet. And a shorter downstream reach that steeply slopes into the original channel, the flume mouth, which had a slope of 0.18, or 18%, a lot steeper, and the length of about 17 meters. The channel elevation at this location is 1,400 meters above sea level, and the drainage area is approximately 24 square kilometers. Is that about 10 square miles, more or less? We reached bedrock erosion along the lower slope flume and the steeper flume mouth, where a narrow inner channel has formed. And there's our shot again, and you can see the flume mouth, and there's where it's... and here's a drawing of what you're looking at. There's the fill, here's the culvert, and there's the blasted flume comes out to about here, and then the mouth goes beyond that. And there's the culvert itself, 14 feet high, 14 feet. And there they have a little ultrasound monitor that they're measuring how deep the water is. Now, the monitor isn't very accurate for very small depths, for what it's worth. But, you know, it gives you an estimate once the floods come through. And it's got a little solar-powered thing so that it can sit there for 7 months at a time, and then they come by and collect the data and then dump it into their computer and look at it. And here's a profile. Now, this is squashed. You'll notice that this is 2 meters here. You notice that this is 20 meters. So this is squashed approximately 8 or 9 times, something like that. It's not really quite this steep. And it's really not this deep. And you can see, though, that this has dropped almost a meter, maybe over a meter, from 1970 to 2005, which is, what, 20-something years? 25 years? The local bedrock is Navajo sandstone, a Triassic-Jurassic Aeolian sandstone that is relatively weak on the core scale. Tensile strength is approximately 0.2 megapascals, but is strong enough to form large cliffs in the region because of its massive unjointed nature. Abundant clasts are overwhelmingly composed of durable diorite. So there's a bunch of stuff on the bottom, and some of it's diorite, which is considerably stronger, originating from the igneous intrusions that form the peaks of the Henry Mountains. Official contacted at the Utah Department of Transportation found no records of when the culvert and channel diversion were constructed. So this happened, we don't know when, but we can make an estimate. The filling of the Lake Powell Reservoir began in 1963 and continued until 1980. And Highway 276 ends at Bullfrog Marina on Lake Powell. So obviously it had to be later than 1963. Maps published in 1965 and 1970 do not show this highway. Were they lazy or it wasn't actually there at the time? We don't know. They have reference for that. But a 1972 map does show the highway. So it's at least 1972. And so they're assuming that Highway 276 and the culvert were constructed around 1970 and that the incision here has taken place since that time. So 25 years and you can cut a meter. But it gets more dramatic than that. Methods. At the Sweat Creek field site, flow depth was monitored using a sonic distance sensor mounted on top of the culvert interior. The sensor measured the distance down to the water surface. Flow depths were calculated by differencing the known distance to the culvert bottom, presumably taken when it was dry, and the measured distance to the water surface. Our configurations do not measure very low flow depths. That's because the beam is about 22 degrees and the culvert is round, so it's hard to pick up exactly. But they're doing the best they can with what they have. Flow depths were recorded once every 10 minutes and represent the median value of measurements taken every minute. So it's actually was taken every minute, and then they stored it. Storing it that way, they could come back every 7 months and pick it up instead of every month or less. University bedrock erosion was measured by, that doesn't count. Bedrock erosion was measured by comparing repeat surveys of local bedrock bed topography. Numerous 4-inch concrete expansion bolts were tightened and epoxied into holes drilled into the Navajo sandstone bedrock to act as benchmarks. So they want to come back next year and find the exact same spot. So they just drilled a little hole, put an expansion bolt in, and tighten it up, and then that way they can find out exactly where they were. We conducted repeat surveys over 8 lines of bolts. However, many bolts were removed by erosion. By the way, those are my ellipses that I missed marking. What happened? Well, they didn't realize how fast this stuff cut down. Flow monitoring. Our monitor flow record shows that the ephemeral channel carries flow from snowmelt on Mount Hillers in some, but not all, years, and also experiences of flash floods from summer monsoon thunderstorms that occur most frequently from July through October. Figure 3, we're going to skip over, shows the hydrographs for flow events that occurred between 26 October and 15 May of 2007. So they're covering about a little less than a 3-year span. Flow from snowmelt occurred for 3 weeks in April and May of 2005 with a maximum calculated snowmelt discharge of approximately 1 cubic meter per second. Every second one of those goes by. By far, the largest short-term discharge event we captured occurred on 5 October 2006 with a measured flow depth in the culvert of 0.7 meters and a calculated maximum discharge of over 9 meters, cubic meters per second. Following the October 2006 flash floods, the entire culvert had a continuous layer of coarse sediment on its bottom, measured below the depth sensor to be 0.13 meters thick. That's about 13 centimeters. It had just filled the bottom of the culvert. Not surprisingly, it filled the bottom of this little slot canyon. We estimate that the recording snowmelt flow transported approximately 8 times more water volume than the flash flood flow. The flash flood, in other words, it was running a lot longer and therefore could transport more sediment, or more water, and also more sediment. But since it's not running so fast, it's not picking up huge cobbles and boulders and stuff like that. The flash flood events from October 2006 account for approximately 90% of the total flash flood flow volume. That was the biggest flash flood by far. We observed in the field that a discharge of approximately 0.5 cubic meters per second, at a discharge of that, all the flow was contained in the flume mouth inner channel, which, depending on where you were looking at, it was 0.4 to 2 meters deep. So that means that the slot canyon actually could take all of the flow at about half a meter per second, which means that at its peak, the flash flood was all over the place and not particularly into the channel, but flooding everything. And at its peak, the snowmelt flow was almost contained, but not quite, by that channel that it had cut, the slot canyon. And I'm going to skip over sediment transport and then talk about patterns of erosion. Threshold of detachment. Qualitative field observation suggests that a negligible threshold of detachment is required to abrade bedrock. Figure 6. The photograph shows a contact between an alluvial channel bed and bedrock sidewall taken in Sweat Creek approximately 1 kilometer upstream from the culvert. The bedrock here is Entrada sandstone, which is very similar to the Navajo. And here, if you'll notice, around these rocks, the water has been diverted and started to erode the side of the channel, which means that at flow rates that didn't move the rock significantly, there was still enough erosion to erode the channel. And you can see it's there, and here's another shot of it. Erosion line 6. Bolt line 6 forms a channel cross-section in the lower slope flume, approximately 20 meters upstream from the flume mouth. Figure 7A, location in figure 2. We'll look at figure 2 again in just a minute. Note 2 incised longitudinal grooves filled with moderate sediment cover. Repeat surveys of the cross-sectional channel topography show that up to 100 millimeters of vertical incision into bedrock occurred as a result of the snowmelt flow between fall 2004 and spring 2005, focused at the topographic lows of the groove bottoms, and it tended to erode the bottom of the channel. Yeah. But little to no bedrock erosion occurred here from flash floods for the duration of our study. You think the flash floods would be more effective? Apparently not. And here's bolt line 6, and you can see A, B, and C, and you can see there's the channels right there. We're looking downhill, and here's where bolt line 6 was, up there, still inside that blasted area. 1 and 8 are here, and we're going to see that a little bit more. flume mouth longitudinal profile. Along the flume mouth, up to 500 millimeters of vertical incision into bedrock occurred during the spring 2005 snowmelt flow. 23 days, half a meter. Photographs and comparisons to other erosion profiles demonstrate that interchannel downcutting did not occur between the spring 2004 and fall 2004 surveys. Later surveys, fall 2005 to spring 2007, omitted for clarity, show no apparent bedrock erosion at this scale, but to clearly show increasing alluvial deposition, shown in figure 5. Here's the downcutting. This is along the, what they call the thalweg. You can see that a boulder got rolled into place here and slowed the erosion significantly. And here you can see what started out as a couple of potholes turned into one big pothole and almost none at all. Erosion line 1, a key element of the incisional response since the flume mouth was constructed and incision began, has been a dramatic narrowing of the zone of flow and sediment transport, forming the inner channel. In the fall, fall 2004, bolt line 1 was installed just upstream of the start of the inner channel, but approximately 450 millimeters of vertical erosion during the spring of 2005 snowmelt season led to the upstream migration of the start of the inner channel. It's cutting its way back. And here, you can see what happened. Here, this is cross-sectional area, and you can see what used to be here in the fall of 2004 went down to here in the spring of 2005, and in the fall of 2005, it's approximately the same. Really, very little erosion except for the spring of 2005. The width of focused incision was less than 350 millimeters. That channel is, what, something like that. Photographs taken in fall of 2004 before the snowmelt runoff and fall 2006 after both snowmelt and flash floods show bedrock incision, alluvial deposition, and bolt deformation by sediment impacts. The bolts were almost torn off, you can see. And some of them, of course, were eroded completely out. Up to 20 millimeters of incision occurred on the upper bedrock surface near bolt F as a result of the fall 2006 flash floods. And let me show you that. Here you can see this is the bolt A, this is bolt F. And there's a couple more bolts that they put in just to try to get an idea. And now, in fall 2004, in the spring, it carved out this area here. Somewhere in the middle of this, probably during the big flash flood, this got carved halfway out and bent. Huge amount of force. You can see this one's also carved part way out. And this one is sticking out. Different surveyed profiles align poorly in places because of the change in surveying method used from using a profile gauge to a total station after the alignment bolts in the center of the channel were removed by erosion. They used to have more points to deal with. The center points just got wiped out. And so now they have to just draw between the two outer ones and drop it straight down, and so you don't get as accurate as you would want. Erosion line 8, I'm going to skip over that for now. Finally, measurements of erosion along bolts 2 to 5 and 7 are not presented, but are consistent with the above results. In other words, they're just more of the same. Pothole formation they talk about, and I'm just going to show you, here's a line 8. And you can see there's some bolts and that have been, one that's been eroded almost all the way out. And there's A and E and D. And presumably there was a B and C in there somewhere, but they're gone. And here you can see the potholes. You'll see there's a pothole here with a pin in there for scale. And there's another pothole starting here. Excuse me. By the time you come back, only one pothole is left, but it has deepened, and you'll get an idea of how deep. That's one big pothole. Discussion. In Sweat Creek, the largest peak discharge events were not the most erosive, which was a surprise to them. As shown by erosion along the inner channel, local bedrock erosion can occur rapidly. We measured nearly 500 millimeters of vertical incision into bedrock along much of the inner channel over 23 days of snowmelt flow, not counting the pothole. This high incision rate is a result of the steep local channel slope, weak bedrock, a disequilibrated channel morphology, and high but not overwhelming sediment flux. Nonetheless, the rapid short-term erosion rates suggest an interesting and converse question. Why are long-term fluvial bedrock incision rates so much lower? Maybe because it's dry? For example, Cook et al. Reported long-term incision rates of 0.4 millimeters per year based on cosmogenic dating of alluvial terraces along a well-adjusted channel in the Henry Mountains. Consistent with regional measurements of long-term incision. Well, this is long-term geologic incision. Maybe those dates are too old. Long-term landscape incision in areas of rapid tectonic uplift, such as Taiwan, can approach rates as high as 10 millimeters per year. They're measuring 500 millimeters in 23 days. You know, skipping over a bunch of stuff, they talk about cover effects, which is basically the idea that flash flood, the bore has so much material that it starts dumping it into these holes rather than gouging them out. Pothole formation. Several arguments suggest that coarse gravel and cobbles, rather than suspended sediment, eroded the inner channel pothole that developed during the spring of 2005 snowmelt season. So apparently it's not just water pouring into it, it's also water that has a few rocks that can be trapped in there temporarily and kind of grind away, going around in a circular motion. Implications for natural slot canyon formation. Finally, we describe several natural bedrock canyons in southern Utah that have morphological similarities to our monitoring site. The comparison demonstrates 2 points. First, the pattern of transient incision seen at the flume mouth is a repeatable response to a sudden channel steepening. Second, channels in which flow is diverted over a steep bedrock slope occur naturally in this landscape, resulting in slot canyon incision. And they're going to show you a couple of them. Pay special attention to Spooky Slot Canyon. And here's the Peekaboo Slot Canyon. And here's the Coyote Narrows. And notice that all of them appear to have an abandoned channel next to them. Here's an abandoned channel. And it looks like there's been some sand dunes that have blown over that and blocked the standard channel and forced the area over to the one side. And that's how you can get that kind of thing. Perhaps there's some ponding there and some of the flash floods come in and dump all of the coarse sediment before they try to traverse the bedrock and basically turn into snowmelt-like conditions. At least that would be one hypothesis. And here's this photo of a spooky slot from approximately here looking in this direction. So let's take a look at it. And you can see that the sand dune has blown over. In fact, it's really piled up. And everything has now headed down towards Spooky Slot. And you want to see what Spooky Slot looks like? That is a person. Skipping on limitations in future work and conclusions, local rates of channel downcutting into bedrock can be fast during the individual floods that actually drive bedrock incision. We measured up to 0.5 meter of local and vertical incision in bedrock over 23 days of snowmelt runoff. And I'll divert into a creationist reference, which is, by the way, where I ran into this. For fun, let's, this is not the whole thing, of course. For fun, let's take the lowest rate measured, 0.4 millimeters per year, and that's, of course, geologic time, divide by 4 to get 1/10 of a millimeter per year. In other words, we're going to cut it way down. And extrapolate it over the assumed age of the Navajo sandstone, 190 million years. That would give you a canyon 19 kilometers deep. Now, remember, it really should be 4 times that. That's over 15 times the depth of the Grand Canyon, eroding at the slowest rate claimed from cosmogenic radionuclide dating, not actual field observations. If we took their measured rate of 0.5 millimeters per year, it would be a canyon 95,000 kilometers deep. By contrast, if you took the very conservative value measured in Taiwan of 10 millimeters per year, you could actually get a decently deep canyon, 50 meters deep, in just 5,000 years. Now, my take on this is going to be a little different from usual. I'm not just going to talk about it. I'm going to show you some photos to compare. Slot canyons erode much faster under ideal conditions than might be expected. Flash floods are actually not ideal conditions, apparently, at least for that size of slot canyon. Rather, sustained floods clean the floor of the canyons better. So what you really need is sustained flow. Slot canyons are common, which suggests that sustained flow was also common, and this is in areas where it is now desert. This is a slot canyon. This is looking into the mouth of one of the places of the wave. This is a photo. I'm not sure whether I or my daughter took this photo. We were up there together. My two daughters. This is looking back into the canyon. This is interesting, what caused this deformation, but we'll let that go for now. There's some over here as well, interestingly, and in a different layer. But here you can see the canyon. This is looking out, and you can see it's just, you know, really cut down. That's at the wave. There isn't much drainage to that particular part as far as I can tell. It happens in Loma Linda. Well, this is not consolidated sediment, to be fair, but you can see we have a nice little slot canyon. Those of you who have been up in the hills may recognize this as a place where three roads join and the river runs right through that, or the creek or wash or whatever you call it. Sweat Canyon itself, a little further downhill, has its own little slot canyon areas. You can see, you know, very nicely slot canyon characteristics there. And here's another shot. This one, I don't know how they got those colors to it. That's just gorgeous. And then there's another slot canyon halfway across the world that is seen by a lot of people. And you can see here is slot canyon. If you lift up your eyes, you can see we're going into a really deep slot canyon. We're going to get about halfway in. You're going to see here, and you see this little knob here. That's going to be down at the bottom of the next photo, right there. And that is a slot canyon. And when you come around the bend at the end of the last bend, this is what you see. How many of you know where this is now? Yeah, okay. It's in Petra. And that's a slot canyon. If you've ever been down it, it's, you know, really high, narrow walls. But, I mean, we're talking really, really high. And that wasn't cut by flash floods, apparently. Now, I think there's a lot that we need to learn about slot canyons. I'm glad these people are doing the research. In some places, it looks like submassive flooding for prolonged but geologically short periods of time appear to be required, and not just flash floods, because apparently flash floods just go through and deposit as much as they cut out. They'll do a nice job widening the canyon, but they won't do much of a job cutting it unless you can find some place to deposit all the rocks and stuff that they carry to begin with. Little rivers chiseling down, especially in places like this where there aren't little rivers chiseling down. There's no river there. They just won't cut it. Erosion rates under the right conditions are astonishingly rapid. It's interesting now to try to build a model with those kinds of constraints. Could we learn something? Could we find something that might be useful in general geology? But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn.
It doesn't necessarily even take sediment transport to be able to do that erosion. In, I think it was 1983, they had a pretty large flood. They almost lost the Glen Canyon Dam because of cavitation in the penstocks.
Yeah.
Those penstocks are about, I'm not sure exactly, maybe 10-foot diameter. And, of course, there's no sediment coming through. But they were dumping, you know, a lot of water because they had everything fully open.
Yeah, and all it had was water. There was no sand or gravel.
Yeah.
Except for at the tail end of it after it picked up some.
Right, but up in the middle of the penstock, I have some pictures in some books of mine, just because of cavitation, they lost, through the concrete overnight, 10 or 12 feet deep holes in the concrete.
And right into the bedrock underneath.
Yeah. Completely, almost eroding the whole thing back up to the head side. And if they'd gone through that, the whole thing would have gone.
Yeah.
So, yeah, this reminds me a lot of that kind of situation. So, as soon as that flow trips on something from laminar flow to turbulent flow, you start getting cavitation, and you can just cut right through that.
I mean, a cubic meter per second is really not very fast.
Yeah, that's only 27 cubic feet per second. That's not a lot of flow. But over a short, concentrated area, the velocity can still be decently high.
Yeah.
And as soon as it, you know, starts wandering around, making turns and stuff, it trips over from a laminar smooth flow to a turbulent flow, and you get little eddies and stuff, and you start creating the cavitation, and that's it. That's all it takes.
Question back here, and Ariel, did you want to say something? Or? Okay.
There are two examples that I can think of. Many of you are probably familiar with the ladder trail at the north end of Salton Sea. It's a very fine slot canyon. My problem is, at the top, there's very little catch basin area or very little area for any rain to accumulate that would cut that very, very deep canyon. My second observation has to do with a Rubidoux nature area here in the Riverside area. In any case, I used to go there quite frequently bird watching, and then we had a severe rain, and the river changed channels and washed away land that had huge old trees that had been there for hundreds of years, and great swaths of willow. Tremendous amounts of material disappeared just from that temporary rushing stream.
Apparently, at least if you're trying to cut in a very narrow canyon as opposed to a broad one. Broad ones you can probably get by with flash floods doing the job, because you can cut the edges of it somewhat effectively because it's not covered with anything to prevent incision. But if you want to cut down, you really need cleaner river flow, at least river flow that does not have a burden of too much of a burden anyway of bed load of the big rocks tumbling down, because they stop the erosion at the bottom.
I can make a comment here about this. This is touching on the what I consider one of the strongest bits of evidence against the geological timescale. And that is that our average rates of erosion are way too fast to permit the continents to have lasted as long as geological timescale would claim. I don't remember all the details. I would refer you to chapter 15 in my book, Origins, where I get all kinds of details about this these erosion rates, but I will tell you this much.
You presented some of them here, I think, as well.
Average of 12 studies of erosion rates of the continents of the world. And this is done by measuring the amount of sediment that the rivers carry to the ocean. You take the size of the basin, and you take the river and so on, you get the rate of erosion for that basin when you measure the amount of sediment that river is carrying into the ocean. Gives you kind of a figure of that. And there have been all kinds of studies this over the world, and the average of 12 studies tells you, well, average erosion rates of our continents is 0.6 millimeters per year, which is 60 meters per million years.
And apparently that's an underestimate for really elevated areas, because in Taiwan they're getting 10 millimeters per year, something like that.
Yeah, well, you get...
I think somebody estimated Mount Everest is going down by 2-point-something millimeters per year.
Yeah, but flash flood, you got tremendous rates of erosion. What are you going to use as your standard? And what I'm using as a standard here is, what's the average of what's going on at present for all the continents of the world? It's as solid a standard as you can get for this. Exceptions, all kinds of them. I mean, it's a tremendous... moving water is to be feared, folks. It's a tremendous, powerful thing. And the faster it moves, the more sediment it'll move. One estimate is that the carrying capacity of water for sediments increases as the third to fourth power of the velocity. To put that in other words, if your water moves 10 times as fast, it carries 1,000 to 10,000 times as much sediment. So moving water is extremely powerful. But no, we're bottom line here, folks. Forget about all these rapid catastrophes and exceptions and so on. Here we've got 12 studies of the discharge of the rivers. And, you know, there's suggestions that, well, maybe that's only maybe about half of what is being eroded by the at the coast by a solution of chemicals. when you measure a river, you don't measure the dissolved minerals in the water. You just measure the solid sediments. So we're conservative by all kinds of factors when we use these figures. But at the rate of 60 meters per million years, how long are your continents going to last? You know, well, the average height of our continents is 600 meters above sea level. That's the average height, which brings up the statement that you'll find in the geological literature, and it's quoted there in my chapter, that our continents should be flattened out in 10 million years. Well, now radiometric dating and all these other ideas and so on says our continents, you know, depends on what kind of model you want for the Precambrian and so on. But we would say, you know, maybe 3 million years. Billion years, I'm sorry. 3 billion years, you know. You could erode your continent over 200 times. Now, be careful with that figure, because often these folks do not take into account agriculture, which has increased rates of erosion. And figures of estimates of agriculture rates doubling are probably very generous. But let's be very generous. So cut the figures in half.
It should have eroded them 100 times over.
I'm sorry?
You still should have eroded them 100 times over.
You still should have eroded the continents 100 times in geologic time, and they're still here. And so the standard answer in the geologic literature is, well, you erode and you renew the mountains from below. Let's keep renewing them. And this totally disregards the fact that you go out there and look at your layers, the old ones are still there. We haven't even gone through one cycle of erosion if you're going to start eroding these mountains. So it's a very strong case that challenges radiometric dating. Rather simple case. That being as conservative as you can, using the lowest figures you can, and so on, your continents should have been washed away at least 100 times in geological time, and they're still here. And the old layers are still in them. Recycling is not going to do it, which is the standard answer in textbooks.
I had some fun one time with somebody discussing Mount Everest in this. Because Mount Everest, of course, gets eroded more rapidly than average because of its height. It's something like 2.3 centimeters per thousand years or so. And it's enough to erode Mount Everest about, 10 times since the Cretaceous, when India is supposed to have slammed into Eurasia. And one of the interesting things that that we looked at was that that Mount Everest still has Paleozoic sediment on top of it. And you can renew Mount Everest from below, but you should be renewing it with granite, not with Paleozoic sediment. Unless there's a whole lot more Paleozoic sediment than we had, it would have had to have been 70 miles to begin with, which seems a little high. That was at the point at which one of my discussants started to get a little abusive.
We've been talking about the erosion and the washing away of layering and diminishing of the layers, and, you know, rapidly in the the canyons. There was a time when these layers were increasing and they were being laid down.
Right.
And the data that we were looking at here is based on the solidity of these layers after a long period of time, however long it was. And could this formation of these canyons have taken place long ages ago, like, as you say, when there was water in the area? And the material, the base material, had a different solidity to it. It was probably
softer
material.
It could have been cut much faster, in other words.
That's right.
Yeah, it requires a constant stream of water in order to do that. You don't want flash floods. You want something that's at least to get the slot canyons. Yeah. Anyway, next week we're going to have some fun with a timed erosion event. 3 days, not quite 10 meters into bedrock. Some spectacular photos. I just had a chance to preview some of it on Google Earth. It's fascinating. But this is between San Antonio and Austin, Texas. For those of you who are curious, Guadalupe River. Come on back, and we're going to have some fun looking at more rapid erosion. And the idea is that you don't take a lot, it doesn't take a long time to cut a canyon. I still want to see a model of the gooseneck, the San Juan. But that'll wait till another time.
Well, you know that there is one paper in the journal Science, I believe, that claims the goosenecks were cut rapidly.
I'll have to look at that paper.
Because of the erosion pattern is not a slow one where you deposit on the inside of the curve and erode the outside of the curve. It's a symmetrical pattern. You go through those goosenecks.
Uh-huh. Well, we'll have to figure out.
They claim that would have been done fast.
Yeah. Well, we'll have to look at that paper too sometime. Anyway, come back next week.